Let me show you a system where you experimentally get a strange attractor. Like the others, the first papers go back to the 70s. And the main one that people looked at, because it's possible to do, was a forced double well oscillator. So some of this is described in section 12.5 of Strogatz. Because the first study was of this magnetoelastic system, which I have in my lab, but I don't have any good video of it. There's this beam, and the beam is attracted to two magnets. In its neutral position, if the magnets weren't there, this bending measured by this deflection X would be zero. So it'd be kind of going up and down. But it's attracted, if you give it a little bit of a push, it wants to go to one magnet or the other. So the downward position is unstable. So if you were to view this in terms of a potential energy curve, the potential energy would look like there are potential energy minima at each of the magnets. And then with energy dissipation, right, any deflection one way or the other, and things just sort of settle down. If you start a little bit to the right here, let's say, then you would kind of settle down due to damping. Now things get weirder if you take this entire frame and then shake it periodically, because then that shaking motion will sometimes make the beam move out to the other well, stay there for a while, maybe go back and forth between both wells. So they studied this and they got a strange attractor. I think it's more intuitive though to think of a ball rolling on a one-dimensional track. So here is a sketch of a ball rolling on a track. So we've got the ball moving back and forth, and it'll show the same type of dynamics as this one up above. And the phase space here would be, you'd look at X and X dot, right? It's a two-dimensional phase space because it's a mechanical system. So it would be described by Newton's laws, X double dot equals something, which then you would turn into two first order ODEs. And there would be damping. When you add forcing though, you could get strange things happening. So we've in fact experimentally worked on this in our lab. Let me show you what it looks like. That'd be kind of loud, but I think you could see that there's a ball moving on a track. And this is just at real speed. So we're oscillating at about 1 hertz. In fact, sometimes, you know, the ball will go off the track. But what you could do, yeah, I don't know if it's about to or what, but you could digitize and then track the ball with tools from MATLAB to get where it is in the X direction and the Y direction in terms of pixels, compare the pixels with distances and actually get how things are moving. And so this is what things look like starting at an initial condition up here at the upper left, kind of middle upper left, and then just following it. This is without any forcing. This thing settles down to the left well. So this is showing the ball kind of processed by MATLAB. It started in one well, but then it settles down in this other well. I think this is slowed down. This seems slower than real time. But then that slowing down leads to that kind of spiraling in to the left well. And there's a model for this, the Duffing system. Duffing did some work on this. So it looks like X double dot plus delta X dot minus X plus X cubed equals, and on the right-hand side, we have forcing, the time-dependent forcing, cosine omega T. So F is the forcing strength. This is the frequency of forcing omega. And it's just like this. We're tracking the ball with respect to the moving frame. So not with respect to the lab frame. This motion looks like it's motion in a potential that's 1/4 x to the fourth minus 1/2 x squared. That gives you these terms. And then this would be damping, right? And this is just the second derivative, so inertia. And we've divided out by m. So damping is a positive constant. And we can look at some simulations of this. If we set delta equals 0.25, and just to simplify things, omega equals 1, and then vary the forcing strength, we can get different things. So we would get stable limit cycles for a certain value of f. We get stable limit cycles for small f. So the energy lost by dissipation is reinjected through the forcing, and you get this balance that leads to stable limit cycles. For a higher F, we get something else. And if you were to look at the plots of X and Y, so here's X and Y time series, you get something like this, kind of look chaotic. The thing on the left almost looks like it could have come from the Lorentz system. And of course, this is messy and hard to interpret. So we want to look at X versus Y, right? Think of this as and what am I saying is Y? Sorry, Y is equal to X dot. So we've plotted X and X dot, and we get something like that. To see it as a true phase portrait, we want to combine. So look at Y versus X, meaning X dot versus X. That should be the phase portrait, right? That would be the right thing to do, right? We should get something we can interpret, right? Well, I see a problem here, and maybe you do too. Trajectories are crossing. They shouldn't be crossing. We don't have uniqueness, right? What about, what's going on here? If I'm there, is the trajectory going this way, or is the trajectory going that way? Like, make up your mind. The problem is we're using just X and X dot, but really the state of the system isn't given by X and X dot alone. It's given also by time, or at least the phase in the forcing cycle. So the state of the system is given by the three variables, X, X dot, and time, or just the phase in the forcing cycle. It's almost like because we have periodic forcing, we have a periodic time variable. So what we could do is, instead of just sort of looking at this spaghetti plot, we can strobe the system. You take initial condition and then look at it only at phase zero. That would be called a stroboscopic map or Poincaré map, or a stroboscopic Poincaré map, because it's like you're strobing. Only look at points when forcing is at phase zero, which in what we're talking about here, this would be whenever T is divisible by 2 pi because of how we chose omega. So if we do that, then we see a pattern emerge that's really cool. We see a strange attractor. So this would be throwing out a bunch of initial points and only keeping what's there after a while. We get something like this. So this is the strange attractor for the Duffing system. And this is just at phase equal to zero. If you look at it at other phases, it seems to be stretching and folding onto itself. So this is showing it stretching and folding back onto itself. The different frames here are just different phases in the cycle. You start with any initial condition and it will converge onto this and then sort of move chaotically on this. And you could experimentally see it. Another point of view that might be helpful, this is just sort of taking a initial condition and it looks like we're threading through here. This is what an initial point does on the strange attractor. This angular coordinate here just corresponds to the phase. You could even try to get at the dimension of that attractor. Francis Moon was one of the first ones. That thing with the beam was called the moon beam. It's kind of cool. He did that experimental setup for the beam, and then they would experimentally see strange attractors. And this is changing the amount of damping. Not sure how they did that, but then they used the correlation dimension to try to calculate the fractal dimension of this thing. So this is showing for different values of damping what the value of the dimension is, at least on that Poincaré section. So it looks like if you were to zoom in, you see more and more structure. So it's something between dimensions 1 and 2. And this shows that as they change damping, right? For very high damping, it's closer to 1. For lower damping, it's more area preserving. There's less dissipation, so it's getting closer to 2. I know Lori Virgin, and he did an experiment mimicking Duffing's equations. He still does chaos experiments, but this was showing, he did a much better version of the ball on the track. But we got the idea from him, had what he called a Scotch yoke mechanism. Look at that Macintosh 2 power supply. it was more like a little roller coaster, I think, so they could very carefully control that it's on the track. Whereas our ball would sometimes roll and slip. So it wasn't rolling without slipping. But they did this, and what did they do? Eventually they show like a strange track. This is showing that, okay, for some values we get boring stuff. Oh, look, we get this other stuff. Okay, they show that. And there it is. An experimental Poincaré section. We never quite got to this level with our experiment. And I think this is just showing different phases of the forcing. And you got theory on the left, experiment on the right. So it's pretty good. Pretty good. Okay.